Bible, but do you know how the Bible reads? Have you ever spent time in the Bible? It doesn't matter whether it's a study Bible or an ABCD Bible or an XYZ Bible. Just study the Bible, my friends. And many people have become experts in carrying their swords, but they don't know how to use the sword. Are you there?
Yes.
So friends, my question to you is, when you are attacked in life, do you know how to use the sword to defeat the enemy in your life? If you are struggling financially, do you know where to go in the Bible to look for hope? If you're battling a sickness, do you know where in the Bible I need to go to receive inspiration? If you are seeking to be in a relationship, do you know where and what passage I need to study to seek God's guidance and counseling in the relationship that I have? Friends, we can win battles, we can destroy the enemy if we know how to use this sword. Are we together? But let's go back to Exodus 17. I want us to take a look at something. Exodus 17 and verse 11. Exodus 17 and verse 11. Exodus 17 verse 11. Exodus 17 verse 11. The Bible says it came to pass when Moses held up his hand. Can you take both your hands? When Moses held up his hand, Israel prevailed. When Moses had his hands up, Israel would win the battle. But when Moses was put his hands down, Israel would lose the battle. When he would raise his hands up, hold his hands up, Joshua was fighting the battle and they would start to win the battle. But whenever Moses' hands would go down, Joshua was still fighting, but now the enemy was having more power. Are you there?
Yes.
Wait a second. When he put his hands down, did Joshua forget how to use the sword? He was still using the sword, right? But then why is it that when his hands went down, Joshua was losing? Because somebody here is saying, brother, I know my Bible. I know what passages to go. I know and I understand it very well. Why is it that I'm still battling with the enemy every day and I still lose every day? I know my Bible and I'm using it very well. I've memorized all the scripture and everything. But I'm still failing in my fight against the sin. What is the problem? It seems like, listen to me, it seems like everything is connected to the raising of hands and the coming down of hands. Are you there? Somebody asks, what's up with the raising and coming down of hands? Let's study this. If you have your Bibles with me, if you have your Bibles, go with me to Psalm 28. Psalm 28. Quickly, quickly, quickly. Psalm 28. Psalm 28. Are you there? Psalm 28 verse 1. Unto thee will I cry, O Lord my rock. Be not silent to me, lest if thou be silent to me, I become like them that go down into the pit. The word pit there is referring to the grave. David the psalmist is saying, Lord, I'm talking to you, I'm crying to you. Be not silent to me. If you be silent, I will go down. And so he's praying to God right now. And when he is praying, he is saying, don't be silent. Read verse 2. Hear the voice of my supplications. When I cry unto you, I will lift up my hands towards thy holy oracle. Did you see that? The psalmist says, Lord, when I pray, I will lift up my hands. Quickly write this. We don't have the time to go there, but write this next text down. It is 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 8. You know what Paul says to Timothy? He says, I will, therefore, that men pray everywhere, lifting up their holy hands. Friends, the holding up of hands is associated with what? It is related to praying. Now listen to me very carefully. When Joshua was fighting on the battlefield, whenever the hands were up, Joshua would win. But whenever his hands would go down, Joshua was losing the battle. It seems like everything was connected to the raising and coming down of hands. But the lifting up of hands represented what? Represented what? Friends, there are many times in our lives We are studying camp, and I understand the Bible, and I go to class, and I attend Bible class, and I understand the deep things about the Bible, but I don't pray. And the reason why we fail over and over again is because we many times are just using the Bible, but we're not spending enough time in prayer. And friends, when we do not pray, we are going to lose every battle of life. Every battle in your sin. I tell you this right now because the Lord spoke to me when I went through the study. The Lord told me, son, you are preaching a lot, but you are not praying a lot. And power is found in those men and women who actually pray. Because when you're praying, you're claiming the strength of God in your life. And here is a beautiful example. Israel was losing when those hands went down. But Israel would win each time Moses was in prayer, interceding for the nation of Israel. I want to end this by reading to you something interesting that happens here. Look at Exodus 17, verse 12. Exodus 17 and verse 12. Exodus 17, verse 12. It says, Moses' hands were... Are you there? Exodus 17, verse 12. But Moses' hands were... What's the word? Moses' hands were?
Heavy.
In other words, Moses' hands got tired, which is why he was putting his hands down. Are you there? Because the man was lifting his hands for so long. When they got tired is why his hands were going down. Is it tiring to lift your hands up like this for so long? Wait a second. Joshua was using the sword in the battlefield. Yeah? Does it take more energy to fight with the sword, or does it take more energy to lift up your hands? What does it take more muscle power? To fighting with the sword. But the Bible nowhere says, and Joshua's hands got heavy. No. Joshua, the Bible says, he was going on and on and on. But Moses on the top, his hands were becoming what? Heavy. Why? You know why? It's easier to use the sword. It's easier to preach. But it's very difficult to pray. If you are told, hey, some big speaker is going to come from the United States, they are a very famous evangelist, please all of you come. This whole place will pack up. Many churches will come to listen. But if I announce today, friends, we are going to have a full night of prayer marathon. The whole night we're going to pray. Everybody come. You know how many people will come? Even from this group. Are you sure all of you will come? For the whole night of prayer. Yes, let's do it tonight. Do you see the responsibility? Aaron was a famous man. Aaron was a high priest, okay? He was a senior pastor, everybody knew Aaron. And he helped Moses raise up his hand. But the other person who came to help Moses raise up, his name is Hur. Have you ever even heard that name before? One was Aaron, famous. And he was helping Moses pray for others. See, there are two very important lessons to learn from this. Listen to me very carefully as we close this. Number one, if you see a brother or sister in church who are struggling and their hands are going down in prayer, friends, go to them and help them pray to God. Are you there? If somebody is struggling in their prayer, I help them, go pray with them. Help them to pray for others and come together in prayer. There is another beautiful deep truth there. Hur was not a very famous man. Not many people know about him. But if Hur was not there that day, Israel would have lost that battle. Hur was a very important man that day in allowing Israel to win that battle. Today, my friends, listen to me very carefully. I see this with my eyes. People who are in the prayer ministry, they are never the most popular people. People who are actually praying, they are never the most popular people, but they are the most effective people. You might not always see them on the pulpit, you might not always see them in the forefront, but what they do is what is actually causing the change. People who are praying are actually the ones who are bringing churches back to life. They are the people who are actually making a difference. And friends, that's what we need today. We need people in the praying ministry. Now, this is my prayer for each and every one of you. When all of you go home, my heart's desire is that all of you will start the prayer ministry in your own church. My heart's desire is you will gather one people. I tell you and guarantee you it is not going to be easy. The devil will attack you. You bring people for Bible study, you'll be fine. You bring people for a seminar, they'll be fine. But you start bringing people for prayer. I have witnessed this, experienced it myself, and I've seen it happen to others. Whenever you will engage in a serious prayer ministry, the devil will fight you like nothing else. Friends, I want to encourage you. You want to see victory in your churches. And you can come to God and test it out for yourself. If you come together as a group, maybe just the two of you or three of you in your church, but who are seriously, anxiously praying for God to revive your church, I assure you, you are going to see a spiritual life and strength and power in your church like you cannot even imagine. God wants all of us, please say. God wants all of us to have the experience of becoming victors, becoming overcomers, becoming champions in our experience of our spiritual journey. And my friends, all of that is resting upon you coming to the Lord and asking Him to be with you, to guide you, to strengthen you, and to enable you to stand up and be strong in Him, because the battles you need to win will only be won as you go down on your knees. Friends, a few thoughts as I close. Try talking to an experienced professional mountaineer who has climbed the highest peaks in the world. They will tell you one thing. When they get to the highest peaks, not these ordinary peaks here, when they get to the highest peaks that exist on this earth, when they get to the top, they have to kneel. When they get to the top, they have to kneel. They say the winds are so strong at the top, if you don't kneel, you are going to fall. Are you listening? Friends, listen carefully. You want to stand strong in your life? When the winds of sin come at you and temptations come at you, learn to kneel in prayer. God will give you the strength. You will become stronger than nothing else. One of the famous evangelists, Pastor Mark Finley, says this. He says, when you go on your knees, he says, you never stand tall. You never stand tall than when you are on your knees. You are the tallest that you can be when you are on your knees. Why? Because you stand with Jesus. You are the tallest. There's nobody taller than Jesus. You are the tallest when you stand with the Lord. Example number two. Go talk to an Olympic heavyweight lifter. Those who lift those heavy weights, have you seen them? They lift up and they have to pull it up like that. And have to stay there for a while before they smash it down. This happens in Olympic. You go talk to an Olympic heavyweight lifter, you know what he will tell you? For the heavier the weight gets, the more I have to bend my knees. If I don't bend my knees enough, I will not be able to carry the heavy weight. For you to carry serious weight, you have to learn to bend your knees. Friends, many of us, the Lord has placed a lot in our lives around us to be able to see. Many of our family members have not accepted Christ. Many of our friends, our workplaces, people in the church, our churches are just dying. There's no revival in the church. And the Lord is calling upon each and every one of you to take up that heavy load, that heavy weight, which you cannot do on your own, which is why you need to learn to bend your knees and come to the Lord in prayer. When you are able to do that, you're going to be able to lift weight like you've never imagined in your life. Then, all of this is possible. Mighty things are waiting to happen if God's people will pray. I invite you to give your life to Him in prayer. If there is one ministry that's actually effective in the church, if today you're thinking, I don't know which ministry to join, I don't know what talent I have, this and that, I don't know where I can be useful, I can give you a suggestion. The most powerful ministry you can join in the church is the prayer ministry. You can actually make a difference in somebody's life. The Lord is counting upon you, He's waiting upon you to come, call upon Him, and claim His power. That you can finish the work that we cannot finish in our own strength. If you'd like to join me in this endeavor, would you like to stand with me as we pray? Let us pray. Your Father in heaven, we thank you so much. What a wonderful and powerful privilege it is that we are called to work with the Master of the universe, the commander of the army of the angelic host. We thank you that you have given us the invitation to come and work with you. We give you glory, Lord. We only give you the glory. This afternoon, I thank you for my brothers and sisters who have come and gathered and have desired to hear your word and the desire to be changed by you. Father, I submit and surrender all of them in your hands. They need you very desperately. Father, we all need you, for without you, we will lose every battle. Father, we're not spending enough time in prayer. We're not calling you enough. We are not asking for enough. We are not knocking on your door enough. As a result, we are failing. Lord, we are failing. Lord, we are failing. Please help us, mighty God, is our prayer. Please help us, is our prayer. Please help us, or else we will perish and die. I give to you your beloved children here. They are young. And Lord, you are calling upon them. And Paul said to Timothy, let nobody despise thy youth. Let nobody look at you and say, you are too young to do this. Because you yourself set the example through Jesus, who was spreading the word at the age of 12. And so we pray, Lord, that you may call upon these young lives to dedicate and surrender their heart and mind, to come to their God in heartfelt prayer and see a great change, a great revival that is waiting to happen as they claim the power of Jesus in their lives. Father, send them with your Holy Spirit fire that they may do what they cannot do on their own. I plead for this and claim this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You are free to stay. Right. Our last session this evening is going to be powerful. You are free to be more than welcome. I'd like to stay.